Okay, you ready for this joke? It's hilarious. Not really, it's okay. Those of you worrying about Democrats versus Republicans, relax. Okay, relax. Okay, here is our real problem. In a Purdue University classroom, they were discussing the qualifications to be president of the United States. It was pretty simple. The candidate must be a natural-born citizen of at least 35 years of age. However, one girl in the class immediately started in on how unfair was the requirement to be a natural-born citizen. In short, her opinion was that this requirement prevented many capable individuals from becoming president. The class was taking it in and letting her rant, and many jaws hit the floor when she wrapped up her argument by stating, "What makes a natural-born citizen any more qualified to lead this country than one born by C-section?" Boo. I'll tell you what, there's a lot of, what do they call that? I told you before, it's called microaggression. It's a new term. Microaggression means where you look for a reason to be offended. Like if you get the door for a lady, and then the lady looks at you and says, "No, thank you, I can get it myself." And she chooses to be offended because you're being a gentleman. Bunch of nonsense, let me tell you. All right, praise God. This, if you have your outline, I want you to take it out. It's called Lot. I've taught down this vein before, never put it in an outline, and got some other things I'm hoping to get to, but it's powerful. Lot is the picture of a carnal Christian. We'll be in Genesis 13, verse 1. Lot is the picture of a carnal Christian. The Bible says in 2 Peter 2, maybe we'll get there, it said how it vexed his righteous soul from day to day with their unlawful deeds being in Sodom. But Lot is definitely a picture of a carnal Christian. The word carnal just means they're sense-led and not God-led. God gave us our five senses, right? Amen. But when we're led by them instead of led by God, that's where we don't want to be. How many of you know we need to be led by God?
Amen.
How many of you know that everything that looks a certain way might not be that way, correct? So we need God's leading. And that's when I ask you just what I was sharing before about getting involved in a particular thing, you know, a particular good cause. I want to make sure it's God, to the best of my understanding. And yes, we can miss it. I get that. But, you know, I hope we don't. Amen. But the easiest thing to do is nothing. But I believe that's the biggest mistake of all.
Right.
And we talk about before where there's no oxen, the crib is clean. But much increases by the strength of an ox, Proverbs 14, verse 4. In other words, if you don't have any ox, you don't have any crap. That's what it's saying. That is exactly what it's saying. But if you have an ox, you get something done, but you have stuff that goes with it. You know, let me tell you something about church. It's hard. You know why? Because you deal with personalities. And I'm an easygoing guy. I'll do whatever you want. Who cares? That's the way I like it. But I can't be that way. I have to be responsible because I will answer to God.
Amen.
And when someone's hurting somebody, I have to deal with it. And I don't like to. I just don't want to do nothing. I just would rather just let, but see, that's not how it works. And my point is there's a lot to it. You know, when we first started preaching the New Covenant, because many years of my Christian walk, I really didn't have the New Covenant. I had bits of it, but I had mixture. You know, mixture. I accepted Jesus as the author of my faith and then resorted to myself as its finisher. That's what mixture is. And so I wasn't preaching the New Covenant. But when we started really hearing that it's about what Jesus did and not about us, that was a tough time. Because a lot of people hear, well, you're saying it don't matter how we live and it don't matter this and it don't matter that. Well, it doesn't matter as far as you're standing with God. That's all based on Jesus. But listen. Sin will not cause God to love you less, but it'll cause you to love God less.
That's right. That's right.
It'll mess you up bad. The wages of sin is still death.
That's right.
You go your own way, there's still consequences.
That's right.
And that's why God wants to lead us. And that's why God wants to guide us. And that's why God wants to direct us. But it's easy just to, you know, not deal with things. That's the easy thing to do. But God wants us to deal with things because He loves people. You know why God won't exalt a lot of people? Because He loves them too much. I'll give you an example. God will not exalt you if you're mean. You can exalt yourself, but God won't do it. If you're mean to people and you hurt people, God will not exalt you. He loves you way too much, and He loves the people that he's calling you to way too much. But he loves you. That doesn't make him love you less. It just means he can't use you at that level. Amen. Praise God. All right, let's go to, we're going to read the first three verses. This is Abraham before his name changed, when God changed his name to Abraham. And it says, Abraham went up out of Egypt, he and his wife and all that he had, and Lot with him into the south. It's interesting that when Abraham left Egypt, which is a picture of when you and I leave into the new birth, notice it's interesting that Abraham took all that he had. You know, some people want to go into God, but not with everything. Abraham's the picture of a sold out believer. Amen? Abram took all that he had. I mean, I'm going to tell you, that's what God's looking for. You know, I listened to something the other day that I heard a man of God say that really blessed me. He was talking about Paul and Silas, and he says, here's a thought. Paul and Silas love God more than they love themselves. And man, that just jumped at me. I said, Lord, I want to love you more than I love me. I want to love you more. You know, that's the key. You know, God gives grace to the humble, but he resists the proud. Well, that makes me want to know what humility is. You know what humility is? It's not thinking more of yourself. It's not thinking less of yourself. It's thinking none of yourself. Why? Because you're consumed with him. You're consumed with him. Oh, it doesn't mean, I'm not talking about you don't know you exist. I'm not talking about that. But you don't care. All you care about is his plan, his purpose, his will. That's all you care about.
Amen.
That's where I'm there. I want to be all the way there. You know, flesh can always revert back. You know that. We always get shocked when our flesh does something because we think, man, I should be further than this. Like my flesh should be better than this. Your flesh never gets better. Amen. That's a revelation to some people. Amen. So Abraham went up out of Egypt. And by the way, Egypt has to do with stress. You know, all the things of the world. It's a picture of the world here. And Abraham went up out of Egypt, he and his wife and all that he had, and Lot was with him, and Lot with him into the south. Now we know Lot was Abraham's nephew. We're going to talk about him. Next verse. And Abram was very rich in cattle and silver and in gold. Isn't that awesome? Do you know if you're a believer, you're rich?
Amen.
Well, that's just spiritual blessing. That's everything. That's holistic. It's spirit, soul, and body. That's what God wants. And as I said earlier, my vision is far exceeding my provision. And I'll bet yours is too.
Amen.
And by the way, God's not calling us to individual visions. He's calling us to work together. The genius of Christianity is that we do it together. Well, I got a vision to do this, and I got a vision to do this, and that's called division. Amen? Amen. See, if the enemy can get you divided through an offense, you're done. No, I'm not, you can come back. That's good news. But if you stay on that path of being offended, you ever seen somebody that's been offended for years? I remember this one couple, and they wouldn't go to this church because somebody's grandparent, somebody offended somebody way back in like ancient history. I'm talking, wow, get over it. You know? But guess what they were doing? Nothing. Nothing but waiting to die. Wow. Abraham was very rich in cattle and silver and gold. He took all that he had. Isn't that interesting? And he went on his journeys from the south, even to Bethel and unto the place where his tent had been at the beginning. Leave this up here. Between Bethel and Hai. Now look at your outline. First of all, let me say this about Lot. And then we'll talk a little bit about Bethel and Hai. Look at your outline. Lot was Abraham's nephew. His name means, are you ready for this? His name means veil. Covering, wrapping. Lot was related to Abraham. They were brethren, so to speak, right? Think about that. But Lot's name means veil. It means covering and it means wrapping. Now we'll come back here. I want you to jump over from the Amplified Bible. 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verses 1 through 3 from the Amplified Bible. And then we'll continue in the outline. You know, being a carnal Christian or a spirit-led Christian is up to me. It's up to you. I can choose if I want to be in a serious relationship with God or a not real relationship. You know, just kind of exist. And yeah, I'm a Christian, but I'm doing my own thing. Amen? Do you know in order for Jesus to be your Savior, he has to be your Lord?
Amen.
Right. Amen.
Amen. See, we think that's just for salvation. But Jesus can't be your Savior unless He's your Lord. He can't. If you confess Him as Lord, not if you confess Him as Savior, you'll be saved. That's not just heaven and hell. It includes that. It's not wrong to use it that way, but it's not incorrect, but it's very incomplete. Salvation means preserved from danger. It means healing. It means health. It means all those things. Amen. This is why you got to stay in the Word until the Word becomes who you are. I can tell, but you can tell where you're at in your heart, which is really where you're at in your understanding, by how you react when situations come at you.
That's right.
When negative situations come at me and I fall apart and all that stuff, that's what's in my heart. Mm-hmm. No matter what I believe with my head, that's what's in my heart.
Come on.
And so what's the key? It's to change my heart. Out of your heart flow the issues of life. The word issues means boundaries. Mm. We're the ones who limit God. Amen?
Amen?
All right. Now this is 1 Corinthians. Lots of picture of a carnal Christian. And this is from 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verses 1, 2, and 3 from the Amplified. However, brethren, who's he talking to? Unbelievers or believers?
Believers.
Believers. Brethren. Adophos. From the same womb. Okay? I could not talk to you as to spiritual men, but as to non-spiritual, men of the flesh, in whom the carnal nature predominates. Now, let me just say this. It's in brackets. I'm going to shock some of you. The Amplified Bible's not perfect. I didn't think I could get that high. The Amplified Bible's not perfect. Brackets means the translators inserted it. Parentheses means it's shades of the Hebrew or Greek. Brackets means the translators inserted it. Okay? You don't have a carnal nature if you're born again. You don't have a sin nature if you're born again.
Right.
Well, then why do I want to sin? Because you don't know who you are in Christ. You need to renew your mind. We all have areas like that. I'm not throwing stones. I'm saying I have areas. No, I don't. No, I'm kidding. No, we all have areas like that, right?
Right.
But we don't have a sin nature. People teach that nonsense. You're not a freak of nature. You don't have a sin nature and a righteous nature. In your born-again spirit, you're the righteousness of God in Christ.
Amen.
What you need to do is to renew your mind to that through the Word of God. That's what the Holy Spirit does. He's showing you who you are. God's not trying to make you into something. He's trying to reveal who you already are in Christ.
Amen.
You put on the new man. You don't become the new man.
Thank you.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. That's Ephesians 4:24. But it says, however, Ben, I could not talk to you as to spiritual, but as to carnal. And then down there it says, men of the flesh in whom the carnal I'm not going there. As to mere infants in the new life in Christ, unable to talk yet. That's good. Unable to talk yet. Next verse. I have fed you with milk, not with solid food, for you were not yet strong enough to be ready for it. But even yet are you not strong enough to be ready for it. Next verse. This is what I'm after. For you are still unspiritual. You don't have that nature. You're just unrenewed. You are still unspiritual, of the flesh, under the control of ordinary impulses. For as long as there are envying and jealousy and wrangling and factions among you, are you not unspiritual and of the flesh? This is what I'm after. Behaving yourselves after a human standard and like mere unchanged men.
Come on.
Mere unchanged men. This is what Lot was doing. You'll see this as we go through this. Lot was operating like there was no covenant with God. Abraham, I'll show you, he was operating in covenant with God. Lot's a picture of somebody who operates like nothing's changed. That's what a carnal Christian is. They operate just like the world. There's no difference. Oh, they may be nicer, but you know there's a lot of people that aren't born again that are nice.
Hello.
Amen. It's not about that. But anyhow, go back to your outline. Abraham's nephew, Lot, his name means veil, covering, or wrapping. Lot is a picture of a carnal, or in your blank there, or sense-led Christian. Lot is related to Abraham. What's the point there? Same family. Whether they're a spiritually minded Christian or a carnally minded Christian, they're in the same family. How many know you can have two children, one is obedient and one is not? Right? But are they brother and sister or brother and brother, whatever? Of course. They're related. So that doesn't change. All right, now look at the, and let me show you this one. Why is it so dangerous to be a carnally minded Christian? Romans chapter 8, verse 6. We'll do the King James, then the Amplified. Just do the Amplified. I'll just quote the King James. For to be carnally minded is death, the King James says. But to be spiritually minded is life and peace. Now watch this. Now the mind of the flesh, which is sense and reason without the Holy Spirit, is death. Death that comprises all the miseries arising from sin, both here and hereafter. Like depression, like sickness, like all these things that people just take it for granted. Listen, fight. Amen. Fight. Amen. That's not your, that doesn't belong to you. Amen. We don't have to put up with it. Amen. Years ago, there was a band called Twisted Sister. And they sang a song called, "We're Not Gonna Take It." But we take it. Golly, I'm really getting bad. I'm quoting Twisted Sister. But the point of it was, why do we take things? Why do we think this is normal? Fight. I tell my wife all the time, I said, you know what? If you fight and you go down swinging. But at least you fought. Next time it'll be easier. Whatever. But see, we're in a battle. But we just went, oh, things are good. God must be on my side. Things are good even if God isn't on your side. We were listening to Bill Johnson last night on that God is Good video, and he talked about when they were believing for his dad to be healed. And he didn't get it. And they'd seen people healed of what his dad died of many times. But he didn't receive it for whatever reason. And he loved the Lord. They didn't understand that. He said, but you know what? I chose to praise God and rejoice that God is good. God didn't take him. Listen, let me tell you something. We need to get a big picture mentality here. If you believe God for healing and you die, you go to be with the Lord. If you get a healing, you rub Satan's nose in it. Amen? If you receive it, guess what? It's a win-win. You can't lose. Isn't that awesome? That's why Paul said, go ahead, kill me. What do you do with a guy like that? For me to live is Christ and to die is gain. Go ahead. Have at it. What do you do with a guy like that? See, this is why the Bible says in Hebrews chapter 2 that God wants to deliver those, or that he delivered those who were all their lifetime subject to bondage because of the fear of death. Death for the believer is just crossing over. You just step into another realm. Oh, glory. You're not hindered by this mortal body anymore. We need to get a big picture mentality. Okay, let me say something to you. 100 years from now, what's it going to matter what somebody said to you? How about 50 years? How about 25 years? Even 10 or 5 years or even a year? It's not going to matter. It's not going to matter. None of it's going to matter. What matters is the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Amen. Amen. Praise God. So Lot is the picture of a carnal or sense-led Christian. Lot is related to Abraham. Look at point number two. Look at number three there, Genesis chapter 13, verse 3. In our journey through life, we have a choice of where we will dwell. Well, wait a minute. I'm already in Christ. I've been raised up, seated together with him in heavenly places. Your spirit has. But that doesn't mean the rest of you's relating to where you're at in Christ. Amen?
Amen.
Now watch this. We have a choice. Everybody say choice.
Choice.
Boy, the inclusionists don't like that. They don't think we have a choice. They think God just forces himself on you. Bunch of demonic nonsense. It is. It's evil. Anything that makes you passive in your relationship with God is from the devil himself. And the flesh goes, yeah, I've been looking for this. All right. And he went, watch this, he went on his journeys from the south, even to Bethel and unto the place where his tent had been at the beginning between Bethel and Hai. Now watch this, the word Bethel means house of God. House of God. House of God. The Hai is the same as Ai, and it means heap of ruins. Do you know, in this world, in our journeys, it's like we're always positioned between the house of God and a heap of ruins. Amen? But we're going to see that Abram did some things that put his faith, that aimed his faith at God. If you trust in the Lord, you can't go down.
Amen.
I'm not saying you don't have, in this world you're going to have tribulation, but Jesus said, be of good cheer, I've overcome the world. Let me show you another one. I've showed you this one before, but this is so powerful. James chapter 1 and verse 5, look at it. And I'm going to show you something here. James chapter 1, if any of you lack wisdom, let him ask of God that giveth to all men liberally, and upbraideth not, and it shall be given him. Now we pull that verse out and we apply it everywhere, and that's not wrong. But let me tell you the context. Back up to verse 1. Look at this. Here's the context. James, a servant of God and of the Lord Jesus Christ, to the 12 tribes which are scattered abroad, greeting. These are people that are going through persecution. Next verse. Notice what he says. My brethren, count it all joy when everything's going great. When your things are good. That's what most believers do. I'm happy when things are good, and I'm not when they're not. This is why the Bible says, count it all joy when you go through diverse temptations, testings, and trials. Not for the trial, but for the fact that Jesus is good, even in the midst of a negative situation that's come your way. Count it all joy. That's why you got to count it joy. It's easy to count. I can have joy when things are good because things are good. It's sunny. It's great. It's all those things. But when things are bad, that's when I need to count it joy. Amen. Next verse. Look at this. Knowing this, that the trying of your faith works patience. Look at this. But let patience have her, next verse, but let patience have her perfect work, perfect, complete work, that you may be perfect, complete, mature, entire, wanting or lacking nothing. Next verse. Now let's see it in context. If any of you lack wisdom, how to count it all joy in the midst of trials, let him ask God. He'll give you the wisdom as to how to count it joy in the midst of all kinds of trials. That's what it's saying in context. And see, that's a mature Christian that counts it all joy. But James was instructing those people, saying, count it joy. Count it joy. Why? The joy of the Lord is your strength. Isaiah chapter 12, verse 3 says, with joy shall you draw waters out of the wells of salvation. Amen. Glory to God. You know, if you're waiting on getting to this place where you don't have any more problems, you will never praise God in this life. Guaranteed. Amen. Because there will always be something. Guaranteed. Oh, that's a bad confession. No, that's reality. That's what the Bible teaches. Lift your hands and praise Him. That's what Bill Johnson was saying on that video last night. He was saying, man, I just chose to praise God and to rejoice that God is good. I don't understand. The Bible says we see through a glass darkly, but then face to face. The Bible says then I will be known even as I'm known. You know what? That's a future time, but right now I'm praising the Lord because God is good. He's always good, and He's always good to me. Always. Now back to Genesis chapter 13. Glory to God. Look at Abraham's priority in verse 4. Genesis 13 and verse 4. Let's get verse 3 and I'll run into verse 4. And he went on his journeys from the south, even to Bethel, house of God, unto the place where his tent had been at the beginning. Between Bethel, house of God, and Hai, or heap of ruins, is what that means. Next verse. Unto the place of the altar which he had made there at the first. You know what that's talking about? God was his priority. He was constantly having communion with God. You know Saul, King Saul in the Old Testament? He didn't make an altar until everything was falling apart. You know why? Because God wasn't in Saul's heart. Saul was in Saul's heart. When it speaks of altars, that means Abraham was constantly dedicating himself to God. The Bible says in the New Testament, and we'll come back here, jump over to Romans 12, 1. Look at this. Oh, that's old. This is an old covenant, by the way. This is before the law. Thank you. Wow, time flies. I beseech you, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. Present your bodies a living sacrifice. What does that mean? I present my thoughts to God. I present my actions to God. I present my ways to God as a living sacrifice. Let me tell you something about a living sacrifice. It always wants to crawl off the altar. Amen? Now back to Genesis. Time is flying. Verse 4. Abraham's priority. Watch this. Genesis 13, 4. Abram's priority is the place of the altar, which speaks of dedication and dependence upon God. Amen. Dedication and dependence upon God. New American Standard, Colossians 4, 2. It's in your outline. I want you to see this. We'll come right back to this. Man, I marveled how fast time's going. I think Christian doesn't know how to tell time, but I don't want to hurt his feelings. I believe his dad taught him, so. You missed it, Michael. I guess. All right. Devote yourselves to prayer, keeping alert in it with an attitude of thanksgiving. Wait a minute. I thought we were supposed to devote ourselves to the Lord through prayer. See, when God calls you to pray, he's not calling you to an activity. He's calling you to himself.
Amen.
I'll say that again. God's call to pray is not a call to an activity. God's call to Bible study is not a call to an activity. It's a call to himself through the vehicle of prayer. In fact, the Greek says, you want the Greek? Devote yourselves to the prayer. And I had somebody send me something on the definite article this week, but it's definite article. If we had a whole room of really hard chairs that were hard to sit on, but we had one lazy boy recliner here, and I said, Rich, sit in the chair. It distinctly marks out that lazy boy recliner, right? Rich says, amen. Okay, so devote yourselves to prayer, keeping alert in it with an attitude of thanksgiving. Now, so Abraham's priority, as you go back to Genesis 13:4, is the place of the altar, which speaks of dedication and dependence upon God. Look at verses 5 through 7. I'm going to fly here for the sake of time. 5 through 7. Now Lot, remember his name means veiled, who went with Abraham, also had flocks and herds and tents. I mean, Lot had a lot. Next verse, verse 6. And the land could not sustain them while dwelling together, for their possessions were so great that they were not able to remain together. Verse 7. And there was strife between the herdsmen of Abram's livestock and the herdsmen of Lot's livestock. Now the Canaanites and the Perizzites were dwelling then in the land. Verses 5 through 7. Abram and Lot were both very rich, which resulted in Proverbs 14:4. I said it earlier. When you have a lot like these guys did, you also have a lot of problems. You know what an old timer told me once? He now lives in heaven. He's went on to heaven. But he told me this, I'll never forget it. He said, little church, little problems. Big church, big problems. I thought, that's pretty wise. You know, sometimes when we get the increase of God, there's stuff that comes with it. This is what a lot of people don't realize about ministry. They think, you know, they flip on TV and see T.D. Jakes or, you know, Billy Graham Crusade or whatever they see, and they see all these people like, wow. But they don't know all that stuff that person went through. They don't know all the things, you know, and just like being president of the United States, how would you like to be president? I mean, everything you do is criticized. Everything you do. Well, I itched my head this morning. Oh, that means he was with the Russians. Putin does the same thing. Craziness. Amen. All right. Abram and Lot were both, look at verses 8 and 9. I love Abram here. Watch this. Verses 8 through 9. And Abram said unto Lot, let there be no strife, I pray thee, between me and thee, and between my herdmen and thy herdmen, for we be brethren. You know, Abram was a peacemaker. The Bible says in Matthew chapter 5, blessed are the peacemakers. In James chapter 3, verse 18, and the fruit of righteousness is sown in peace of those who make peace. Endeavoring to keep the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace, Ephesians 4:3. Right? God's about, as much as it lies in you, it says in Romans chapter 12, live peaceably with all men. In other words, go for it. Some people you can't be. Those are people you just say, okay, I tried. But God likes peace.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. You know where there's envying and strife? According to James chapter 3, there's confusion in every evil work. You know, strife's not worth it. Me and my wife, we've talked about this. And how I heard Rick Renner was talking about how him and Denise, they just have an agreement. No strife.
No strife.
No strife. I think that's awesome. You know, you can have a disagreement, but you don't have to handle it with strife. Amen. You can work through it. I mean, but see, why? Is it because God's going to judge you? No, because you open a door to slew foot. You open a door to the enemy. That's why it says where there's envying and strife, there's confusion in every evil work. I heard a story about a man, and they were doing, oh, I don't know why God took this person. I don't know why God, you know. Well, they were talking about how that morning he got in a big fight and with his mom, and his mom threw him out and said, you know, hate each other, all that kind of stuff. You open the door to the devil.
Amen.
That's why if you have little kids, trying to reason with Johnny or argue with Johnny is not the answer.
Hello.
The rod of correction is.
Amen.
It is. That's the answer.
Amen.
Because if you have a house of hollering and strife, that's not condemnation. That's saying God loves you. That's the word chastening. You're saying, you know what? I don't want to live this way.
That's it.
I don't have to live this way. Amen. God loves you. Amen. Praise God. So Abram was a peacemaker, verses 8 and 9. He said, look at this. We're brethren. You know what? If we have a conflict in the body of Christ, we're brethren. We're brothers, sisters. Next verse. Is not the whole land before thee? I love this. Separate thyself. Abram telling Lot, separate thyself. I pray thee from me. If thou wilt take the left hand, then I will go to the right. If you depart to the right hand, then I will go to the left. Isn't this amazing? Abraham had such a trust in God. He said, you go to the left, I'll go to the right. You go to the right, I'll go to the left. You pick. That is trusting God. That is trusting God. You know, can I tell you something? You don't have to exalt yourself in anything. In anything. Do you know if you seek God, God will find you. You know what the Lord told me a while back? He said, this is when I was out in Colorado. He said, let it come to you. Don't do anything to promote yourself. I'm not saying don't be available, but you don't have to promote yourself. Thank you. Isn't that awesome?
Amen.
Let me show it to you, just so you know I'm not making it up. John chapter 5, verse 44. See, a lot of times we look for an identity in what we're doing in our ministry instead of what Jesus did. And that, my friend, has to die.
Amen.
Seriously, how does it die? You just keep looking at Him. You just keep looking at Him. You don't even have to make it die. You just look at Him and be willing.
Right.
Amen. Praise God. Look at this. What did I say? 44. I think it's John 5, 44. Look at this. Jesus said, how can you believe which receive... This scripture fascinates me, by the way. How can you believe which receive honor one of another and seek not the honor that comes from God only? How can I believe if I really think that it's about man's approval instead of God's approval in what I'm doing? Isn't that amazing? Isn't that amazing? I think it is. So Abram was a peacemaker, and Abram trusted God. Turn your things. We're flying. We're just about done. Okay, Lot. Look at Lot, verses 9 through 12. Boy, there's so look at all them verses. There's a wonderful verses there. Lot. It says. In Genesis 13:9, Lot's, I've entitled this heading, Lot's Carnal Reasoning. In other words, he was led by his senses. And now look at verse 9. It's not the whole land. He said, separate. I read that. Verse 10. And Lot lifted up his eyes and beheld all the plain of Jordan, that it was well watered everywhere before the Lord destroyed Sodom and Gomorrah, even as the garden of the Lord, like the land of Egypt, as thou comest unto Zoar. Next verse. And then Lot chose the plain of Jordan. Notice what Lot did. Lot looked and he saw this is the best opportunity. He went strictly by the sight of his eyes and not by the leading of God. Abram had such a relationship with God. Why? Remember back in verse 4 when Abram made an altar? He had a relationship with God. You could say it like this. He had a devotional time where he spent time with God. He got to know the Lord. Right? So he was so confident that God was good to him. He said, Lot, whatever way you go, I'll go the other way. I trust the Lord.
Thank you.
Wow. You know what? You know what I'm learning? God is bigger than my mistakes.
Hello.
You know, because the enemy wants you and I to think that, well, we blew it too big. We haven't been what we should have been. We should have done this. You know, wherever you're at in your walk with the Lord, there's nothing that's bigger than the blood of Jesus. Nothing that's bigger than. There's no mistake you've made that can keep God's goodness from manifesting in your life if you'll just turn your head and look unto Jesus. Isn't that exciting? See, I used to think my mistakes have taken me out. That doesn't mean I don't have to change. That doesn't mean God's not working on my heart. He is. But you know what? As long as I keep looking at him, I think of Abraham. You read about him in Romans chapter 4. It says, Abraham staggered not at the promise of God through unbelief, but was strong in faith, giving glory to God. I think Abraham staggered. He had an Ishmael. But God said he didn't stagger. Wow. Doesn't that give you hope? Doesn't that give you hope? And notice he was strong in faith, giving glory to God. He made it about God and not about him.
That's it.
And God says he didn't stagger. You know how many people could have come? Yes, he did. Yes, he did. People could have, look at this. He did stagger. God said he didn't because he was giving glory to God. He was looking at God. He was looking at God's perfections and not his imperfections.
There you go. There you go.
Whew, my word. That makes me want to do a jig. Like the old Baptist preacher, when I first got saved, I went to a Baptist church, and Burl Gamble, anybody know him? He's deceased now. He would take his teeth out, he'd sit them on the pulpit, and he would do this chicken walk. Thank God! And I thought, man, that guy's anointed. I was super impressionable. I was really impressionable. Like there was another lady I knew, and she'd go, oh. I thought, oh man, is she spiritual. I talk about naive. Anyhow, let's call. Then Lot chose what looked good, and Lot journeyed to the east, and they separated themselves, the one from the other. Now watch this. Look at verse 12. Abram dwelt in the land of Canaan, and Lot dwelt in the cities of the plain, and pitched his tent toward Sodom. What looked good? Next verse at that time. But the men of Sodom were wicked and sinners before the Lord exceedingly. Next verse. And the Lord said unto Abram, after that Lot was separated from him. Notice when God, thank you. Notice when God talked after Lot was gone. You know, sometimes we got to separate from some people. I don't mean we don't hate anybody. I'm not saying that at all. But sometimes you can't hear when everybody's around you giving their opinion of what they think God's telling you to do. What they think of what you just got to get. Lot, God didn't speak until Lot was gone. You see that? Isn't that amazing? Wow. After that, Lot, and the Lord said unto Abram, after that Lot was separated from him, lift up now thine eyes and look from the place where thou art, northward and southward, eastward and westward. Now look at the other, so this is good. Look from the place where you're at. A lot of people won't look until they get to the place that they think they should be. Then they'll look. God says, look from where you're at. Can anybody see that? God's saying the same thing to you and I today. Look from where you're at. Maybe your marriage is this. Maybe your marriage is not. But begin looking and begin seeing yourself in a good marriage. Begin seeing the blessing of God in your life from your heart right where you're at. Yeah. The Bible says, and I believe it's Proverbs 17:24, wisdom is before him that has understanding, but the eyes of the fool are in the ends of the earth. He's always looking out there for what he has right here.
Thank you.
Hallelujah. Man, that's good. We're just about done. I'm hurrying. Hang with me. And the Lord spoke to, look on your outline. The Lord spoke when Lot was separated, instructed Abraham to see from where he was. And then there's a wow there. You spell that W-O-W. You spell it backwards, W-O-W. Many do not see from where they're at. Many do not see from where they're at. That's why they're constantly given to change of allegiance. Proverbs 24:21, the Amplified Bible says, do not meddle with them who are given to change of allegiance. All right, now look at the next one. Number 8, I'm flying. I'm just about done. The promise is to you and your descendants. Let's read on. Next verse. For all the land which you see, to thee will I give it, and to thy seed forever. Stop. Whoa, whoa, whoa. Look at that. To all the land that you see, all that you see from your heart, everything, I'm going to give it not only to you, but to your descendants. You want me to show you that? Watch this. We'll come right back here. I'm flying, Chris. Psalm 115, verse 13. Look at this. Psalm 115, verse 13. He will bless them that fear and reverently and worshipfully fear the Lord, the Amplified Bible says, both small and great. Next verse. The Lord shall increase you more and more, you and your children. Somebody say amen and say amen. I receive that. God will increase you, not only you, but your children. Start saying what God says. Can't help it. I'm excited. Man, that's good news. One more verse. Look at this. You are blessed of the Lord, which made heaven and earth. One more amen. Amen. All right, now back to glory to God. Genesis 13, verse 15. We're just about done. There's only 18 verses in this chapter. For all the land which you see, to thee will I give it, and to your seed forever. Next verse. And I will make your seed as the dust of the earth. In other words, you're going to be fruitful.
Amen.
Hallelujah. as the dust of the earth, so that if a man can number the dust of the earth, then shall thy seed also be numbered. In other words, it's going to be so big, you can't even number it. You can't even number it. Let me show you this one. Psalm 71. Watch this. Verse 14. 14. And we'll do New King James, if you don't mind. But I will hope continually, and yet will praise you more and more. Next verse. Verse 15. My mouth shall tell of your righteousness. My mouth shall tell. My what shall tell? Mouth shall tell of your righteousness and your salvation, your deliverance. How often? For a 15-minute devotional. All the day, watch this, for I do not know their limits, unless it's limitless. Next verse. I will go in the strength of the Lord God. I will make mention of your righteousness, of yours alone. Oh, glory. Of yours only. Isn't that something? But his blessing is limitless. Limitless. And God wants you and I to receive it. Go back to Genesis 13. We're just about done. We really are. I'm trying so hard. There's just so much. For all Genesis, next verse, 16. And I will make the descendants. We read that. Next verse, verse 17. Watch this. Arise, get up, walk in the land through its length and its width, for I give it to you. Now look at this. Look at your outline. Corresponding action starts from the heart. Now we'll see this because verse 18, look at this. Then Abraham moved his tent. Sometimes we've got to move our tent, right? And went and dwelt by the terebinth trees of Mamre, which are in Hebron, and built an altar there to the Lord. This guy's an altar building guy, isn't he? This guy's someone who's constantly looking at the Lord. He's constantly making it about God. You don't see that anywhere with Lot. Lot just went by what he saw. Now, our choice, Deuteronomy 30, verse 19. Deuteronomy chapter 30 and verse number 19. We're just about done. I call heaven and earth as witness today against you that I have set before you life and death, blessing and cursing. This is a multiple choice test, but here's the answer key. Here it is. Therefore, choose life. Here it is. That both you and your descendants, look at that, may live. Choose, but notice you got to do something. Choose life. Choose life. Genesis 15, 16, I think. I may be wrong on this one. I think I am. If then, we'll do Matthew 6, 33. I'm wrong. I'm thinking where it's at. But anyhow, 18:13, try that one. Hey, I'm allowed to do this. So many verses in my brain. Nope, not that one either. But it's a place where Abraham says, I know Abraham that he will command his children so I can bring the blessing of God upon him and his descendants. Isn't that awesome? One more, Matthew 6:33, and we're done. Our corresponding action. Seek first the kingdom of God and your righteousness. No, did I misquote that? His righteousness. Seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. And all these things that we worry about, what we're going to eat, where we're going to live, who we're going to marry, all those things will be added to you. But you see, someone said, and it was brought up earlier. I want to show you this one. Deuteronomy chapter, or Hebrews chapter 11, verse 6, and we are done. Look at Hebrews 11, 6. I want to show you this. It was mentioned earlier by my wife. Why does God reward diligent seekers? Does anybody know? Is it because you have to get to this place where you've sought God enough, and now he says, okay, now I'm going to bless you. Is that why? No. Because those are the only ones God can bless. Because if a tree don't stay planted, it can't bear fruit. That's why Jesus said, abide in me. Those that are planted in the house of the Lord shall flourish in the courts of our God. Not those who are planted, then upplant, then upplant. Those who are planted in him. Now watch this. But without faith, faith has an object, what Jesus did. But without faith in what Jesus has done, I'm paraphrasing, it is impossible for you in your effort to please God. Okay? Without faith, it receives what he's done. It's impossible for us to please God. For he that comes to God must believe that he is, Not only that he exists, but that he is who he said he is, and he rewards the diligent seeker. Why the diligent seeker? Because the diligent seeker keeps looking at God no matter what. He counts it all joy when he goes through stuff. He's constantly rejoicing. He's constantly looking at the Lord. Amen?
Amen.
And because of that, fruit doesn't happen overnight.
Come on.
Amen?
Isn't
that exciting?
Yeah.
So Abram is a picture of a Christian who's serious about his relationship with God. Lot is a picture of a veiled Christian. I wanted to get to 2 Corinthians 3 because I wanted to show you the veil. You can have a veil upon your heart even as a believer.
Yes.
Did you know that? Your heart can be veiled, but when your heart turns to the Lord, that veil's taken away and you see it's about Jesus. Amen. It's fourth down. Christian's going like this. That's fourth down. Amen. Praise God. Give the Lord a hand.